This next speaker that we've got going on here has been featured in stories from The Register, Threat Post, Business Wire, and even more, so you know he's a heavy hitter when you got people writing about him. He's going to show us how to find that one meaningful record out of millions of others, Mr. James Plegar.
Hey guys. Hopefully everyone can hear me. If there's volume issues, feel free to shout at me and tell me to speak up or, you know, shut up. I don't really know which one will be better. My name is James Plegar. I'm over at Fish Tech Group. You know, today I just kind of wanted to go through, the agenda will look like this. We'll go do a quick intro, kind of overview the technologies, look through, you know, the different types of data storage options people have today. We'll kind of go through some of the big data related stuff that people seem to love to throw out, buzzword bingo all the time. I'm going to go through some basic frameworks that you guys can use to think about data, process data, and hopefully do something with that. And then, you know, I'm going to leave it open a little bit for questions. It's only a 25-minute talk, so I'm trying to put as much content in as possible. And hopefully it won't be too quick, and we'll have a little bit of time towards the end. So about me, you know, I've done a lot of different things inside of my career. I've done everything from reverse engineering malware all the way to, you know, doing analysis and, you know, dealing with large sets of data and trying to comb through it, figure out what's going on, you know, and basically go through and find needles inside of giant stacks of data. I mean, a lot of times, if you guys are familiar with a typical corporate environment or any sort of environment where there's lots of data being generated, you do understand how difficult it can be to find that signal inside the noise. You know, I've got a lot of experience of that. It takes as much art as a science on some of this, but it's really important for folks when they're ingesting data and dealing with it to do it in a reasonable manner. And we'll kind of go through that. I currently work over at Fish Tech. We're doing the after hours, so you can go outside and smoke. So we're gonna have some beers tonight. Hopefully I'll see, you know, everyone out here. There's some Fish Tech guys here in the room too as well. And you know, hopefully you guys will have a really good time. Over at Fish Tech, we actually do a lot of really cool and interesting work. You know, I'm not gonna do us any justice, but it's also not a product pitch. I'm not here to try to, you know, sell you a product or anything like that. And we do a lot of focus on AWS, Azure environments. I hate using cloud, you know, as a word because it sounds really buzzwordy and salesy and stuff like that. But I work under the Cyderis group, which we're using to launch a bunch of new products over at Fish Tech. And we leverage a lot of different technologies inside of our stack to help our customers identify, you know, that data inside of very large data sets. Like I said again, hopefully we'll see you guys tonight at happy hour. That's definitely one of my favorite things with conferences, is getting out and socializing with everyone. So, without much ado, I kind of really think it's important to go through the history and understand how new a lot of these technologies are. This is by no means an extensive list of all the different technologies that are out there, but it kind of shows you the rapid pace in which some of the stuff has been, you know, developed. In 2004, we saw the big release of Google's white paper on MapReduce. And it was basically how to, you know, push out all your different queries and produce all that data back so you could deal with things like terabytes and petabytes of data. You know, they had so much data in the crawling space, and nobody had really done large open research in this area. And that paper actually, like, paved the way for a lot of technology. I mean, HBase, all the Hadoop ecosystem, pretty much everything came out of that as a result of that. And it's really important to know how quick some of this stuff happened, especially in 2006, 2007, 2008. Basically, we saw, you know, new data storage mechanisms. There was like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of different projects that came out to address some of the issues and implement some of the stuff that, you know, Google paper talked about. And we saw this kind of renaissance in, you know, storing data, normalizing it, processing it, you know, things like that. But the really important ones, you know, I have Splunk on there, but this talk is actually focused more on you know, open solutions. You can, there's a lot of Splunk experts out there. You know, it's obviously kind of a more closed off ecosystem. So we're going to focus on kind of the free and open source stuff. But the big ones, you know, Redis, I mean, Redis has only been around for 7 years. And these were like the first 1.0 releases that these came out. And, you know, so these technologies have only been out for a few years. And that's really the emphasis that you guys should take from that, you know, on these. So the Elasticsearch as well, which is a lot of people use today. And in fact, I think that's probably one of the widest used for searching documents, being able to quickly retrieve information, things like that. It was only released in 2010. So we're talking about less than 10 years that some of these data storage mechanisms and retrieval mechanisms have existed. So when I talk about a ideal state, I think of how poor some of my previous jobs were. We were, you know, I've been around for a while, so you know, I hope I don't sound like a crazy old guy, you know, went uphill both ways or anything like that. But we basically had breadth, you know, for a long period. And if you were really smart and had a lot of data, you might have had distributed, you know, breadth nodes, you know, going across all your different data sources and things like that. But today, if you're looking at storing large amounts of data, there's no way that you can actually do that. You know, in a reasonable manner. You know, you have to think about how you're structuring your data, you have to think about how you're storing it, what sort of strategies you want to access it, and all these different components that go into creating a decent program to pull security data from. You know, we've got new data like host data, so being able to see every single process that executes on an endpoint, that's a lot of data. I mean, if you think about that from just a pure data standpoint, you're talking about millions of events over the course of a week or two per asset. And so filtering that and understanding what sort of data is available and being able to you know, figure that out is actually a really, really interesting problem. You know, you've got application logs, you know, for places that are well instrumented. You might have SaaS type of services, so you might have Google or Outlook 365. And the ideal end state is you're able to pull all that data in as a company and be able to do something with it. You know, and really, you know, and I'll touch on this here in a second, but you know, people look at that data and they kind of get overwhelmed. They don't understand, you know, how I should store it, what kind of technologies should I use. You know, is there stuff that I should keep? Is there stuff that I should throw away? And it just turns into this giant, you know, data repository that nobody really cares about, and because it's there's so much stuff in there, it's hard to actually use. So, I hate using buzzwords, but you know, big data doesn't mean that you have to have some of these big problems. There's a lot of technology out there today. If you're going out there and building your own, you know, big data normalization thing, you know, honestly, you really, really need to look at ecosystem that's out there, because you know, I hate to say it, but our problems are not specific to security. In fact, our problems might actually be a little bit easier than some of the problems that other you know, companies and other data driven type of environments use. So when people say, well, it's security data and I just can't do anything with it, I kind of turn it back to them and say, well, are you using the right tool? And that's really what we need to focus on here. I mean, you know, if you think about it like analytics companies, you know, you think about any of these, you know, taxi cab services or anything like that, they're dealing with hundreds of millions of events per second. And to say that security data has more data and is harder to solve than that is kind of disingenuous, I think personally. You know, and really what you need to do is break it down into a couple steps. So one, I know this sounds stupid, but you almost need to go through and determine what your requirements are for data before. I'll break down some of this a little bit further here in the next slides. You need to somehow normalize your data. So extract out key information from your data and be able to use that. And then you also need to validate the results. So nobody cares if you've build something that's super cool and you know, does all this whiz-bang stuff, if you're not getting the data that you're expecting out of your system. Or you know, one of the things that I see a lot of is kind of like BitRock, where, you know, they're indexing wrong fields, they're extracting the wrong values, and the data is just useless. You know, so don't do that. I've seen it too many times. So on determining requirements, one of the biggest things that I like to walk through with people is understanding, you know, what kind of unprocessed and raw data storage requirements are there. You know, some companies, they're going to have regulatory requirements. So for example, if you know, you're in the government or you're in healthcare or something like that, or you're bound by some sort of regulatory environment, you might have requirements to store that data for a period of time. You know, it sucks, but take it into account and just you know, build that out as far as your requirements initially. The other thing is you need to figure out what sort of questions you want to ask of the data. If I'm doing threat hunting, you know, I'm going to have a lot of questions like, have I seen this hash? Have I seen this IP? Have I seen a domain? You know, things like that. And you want to optimize the way you're storing the data based off the questions that you're asking. And a lot of people don't do that, you know, just being totally honest with you. You know, their storage and the way they deal with data is totally different than the way they want to actually perform some sort of action on that data. The other thing is you need to also understand that there's different ways of loading data, and there are pros and cons to the different types of loading data. And again, this goes back to your requirements. We could literally get into a talk for like each one of these subjects, and we could probably talk like 2 hours on each one of these. So again, it's an overview. But you know, whether you're doing it as one big ingest, like an ETL process, where it's more of a traditional you know, data storage model, you might be storing things in a database or something like that, versus a pipeline approach or some sort of you know, message-based approach, there's different requirements. And honestly, some things might work really well for one use case where they aren't in another. So that's, it's important to understand the options that are out there and the advantages and disadvantages and some of that stuff. I will say there's some general best practices that you can do at your security data. So one, think about your data as buckets, and think of them as, you know, I have system logs that are related to host information, or I have, you know, security logs that are events from my IDS or something like that. There might be forensic artifacts that are large disk images or memory dumps or something like that. And then there's also things that give you a kind of general overview of health of the network, health of different devices and things like that, that come in the form of counters. And counters are really, really useful because you can summarize the data, be able to look at trends, you know, just very quickly and understand what's going on at a glance. You know, the other thing, you know, I kind of go deep into some of the bucketing on that just because I see that as the area where a lot of people kind of make mistakes, is they don't categorize and bucket their data correctly. But the nice thing, if you do that, you can actually, you know, create retention policies. So you can say, hey, for security events, I'm going to keep those for 2 years, you know, versus something where it's like host logs, where I don't really care about it. We can fold those out into, you know, another, you know, in 6 months or something like that. When we know that we're never going to use it, you know, things of that nature. I highly recommend people store original data because at a later date, oftentimes you can go back and reprocess it. So for example, if we have a totally different, unique way of processing, you know, some data set, and we want to run that against our old data, if you don't have the original data and all you have is post-processed data, you are up a creek without a paddle. I mean, it can be really, really bad. The other thing is if your systems that are ingesting that data are broken, then there's no way for you to recover because you tossed out the original data that you worked off of. It's just like in forensics, you wouldn't throw away your original drive, you just put it somewhere for safety. And especially with things like AWS, and, you know, S3 and stuff like that, data storage is super, super cheap. I mean, you know, as long as you have good retention policies and you have processes to purge, you know, data after a certain point, it's actually not the end of the world to store that stuff. I mean, you're talking about, you know, a few hundred dollars a month which for many organizations is not really break the bank. And you know, last point on here is index your queryable data. We'll go into that in a little bit more detail. But back to the raw storage. I mean, you also want to store things like, where did the logs come from? You know, where did this data originate from? What the dates are? Do you want to be able to say, like, I received this at this date, and I also stored that another day, so you can kind of discern which ones are correct. And oftentimes, like, the timestamps are sometimes screwed up because, a lot of people don't know how the clocks work on their servers when they set them up, and it's just a mess sometimes. So keeping that data is actually pretty useful. The other thing, I have a point on here as well. Most of the data that we encounter as security analysts is temporal, and by that I mean, it's time-based data. I mean, most of this data is, event happened at this time, there was another event at this time, and they might be related, but it's very time slice oriented. So think about data in that way as well. When you're storing things, it's a lot easier to store them by date. Depending on your volume, you can do minute, hour, day, whatever seems most appropriate for your company. The other thing, we hear a lot about enrichment these days. We talk about enrichment like all the time. It's another one of those buzzwords that I hate bringing up, but I kind of want to talk to that point. When you have IP addresses, the quicker you can enrich the data with time-sensitive data, the quicker you can actually have some sort of reference for that. Enrichment is a very important process for a lot of security events these days. You want to pull as much data in there. But understand that some of the data doesn't really need to be enriched real time, and it just depends on the needs. There's a bunch of published and subscribed type of technologies. I talk about the AWS portion of things, a lot, but there's tons of different things. I mean, there's Kafka, there's SNAPS, there's SQS, for alerted. There's all these different technologies. And really, my recommendation to everyone is understand they exist, understand their pros and their cons, because you might have different needs than everyone else. There's not silver bullets, and understanding that the stuff is out there will help people create these types of environments. The other thing that's really interesting here, especially when we talk about enrichment, is storing raw artifacts from enrichment. A lot of people discard that and assume that they are storing the correct data from their enrichment process, and the results of that aren't good. My recommendation to people is keep those raw results on expensive operations, because some of these things, you might parse them correctly, you might have errors in, if you're talking about services or APIs or things like that. And it's a lot easier to store it and not need it than need it at a later date. Some other thoughts on enriched data storage. Again, this comes back down to, you have to understand what you're querying for, because your storage for those enriched artifacts are going to be different than somebody else. Like, for example, if you have an internal IP database that gives you asset information and things like that, that process might be different than some other folks that have similar types of data processing. The other thing that you need to be worried about as well when you design a system is understand that some of these systems that are very, very new, they don't offer good data durability. And the durability is a problem when you're talking about only having a single source of record. So understand that the durability on data can be a requirement as well. Let's talk about storage engines. One of the biggest things that people come to me and say is, like, there's no freaking way that I'm going to use MySQL. That's old school stuff. I got to use NoSQL. Like, there's no possible way that this will scale to what we need. I hate to break it to people, but sometimes database, relational databases are actually extremely useful and they can scale. A lot of times what happens is the applications have been designed incorrectly and the applications themselves have issues with scale. You know, Facebook still uses MySQL in a lot of their environments. Pinterest, they have huge MySQL environments, but it takes a specialization to keep those up and running. Just like a NoSQL database is going to take specialization to keep that up and running. So don't immediately discount those as options, especially when you're talking about relational data. That's just kind of a rant that I don't need to get on a soapbox on that. On the NoSQL side of things, again, there's probably, I'm not even kidding, probably about 100 different NoSQL projects. And everyone has their own opinions on each one of these things. Don't get wrapped up in, like, this is the new thing that came out and it's going to solve all my problems and stuff like that. I mean, understand the pros and cons to each different type of system that you could potentially use. Don't just jump in. Because I've seen people where they do that, and basically they get totally screwed because the type of data that they're storing is not good for that storage mechanism. So just some advice on that. That's most of that. Oh, the other thing that I didn't really touch on is sharding. So sharding data is basically logically segmenting that into multiple data stores so that you can access it quickly. This is one of the problems that most people have with relational databases, is they want to put everything in one giant database. My recommendation is, create your schema, figure out a good, sane sharding strategy so that you can scale that out as needed. If you aren't doing a very good job in sharding your data, you're going to have issues. You're not going to have a lot of time. So that's that on kind of the storage. Indexing, oh my gosh, this is like one of the most important things that you can do as an analyst or building out data structure or data stores, things like that, is be able to index this data and access it quickly. I cannot tell you how many hours I've wasted in areas that aren't indexed correctly. So things like Elasticsearch, honestly, Elasticsearch is pretty baller, I'm not gonna lie.
Reach.
What's up?
Breach.
Breach?
Breach.
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 Boom! Praise me, Elasticsearch. But seriously, I mean, the Elasticsearch is awesome. And it's amazing how, I mentioned earlier, from 2010 to now, I mean, it's just ridiculous how quickly some of these things have come out. And it's fast, but, one of the things that you really, really need to think about on any strategy like this, if you're doing it yourself, make sure you allocate resources. And I'm not just talking about hardware resources either. I've seen so many environments where you go into them and they basically are, crap because nobody's paid attention to them. Nobody's monitored it. Nobody's understood like what is actually going on in there. They just assume that once they set it up, it'll be good to go. The only other thing, too long didn't read. My recommendations, again, store your data, index it, do something sane with it, and then also monitor your systems that are used to monitor stuff. I hate to harp on it, but understand your queries. Your queries are going to dictate the way you store data. And if you don't understand your usage patterns, you're going to have a difficult time building a system that can actually scale and is usable. And time, dedicate time from a personal resource. Or look at some sort of SaaS offering. There are commercial SaaS offerings that take care of that and actually manage these types of data warehouses. For you, that's my recommendation. If you can't dedicate time and resources to it, you should definitely consider using some sort of service for that. There's a bunch of commercial ones, like Datadog, AWS has their own storage for some of these things.
there's a bunch of different options out there that are really good and mature on the marketplace. With that, questions. I really would love to hear some questions and talk about some problems that people have encountered.
Yes, we got some over here. I'll bring you a microphone, make it easier on you.
So with Elasticsearch, how are you feeling like alerting or correlation of logs?
So one of the things, and I think I might have this on the TLDR slide, but so Elastalert, my reference, like this is basically what I would build if I was at a corporation and building my own. Elastalert is pretty cool. That's definitely a really, really good tool. Highly recommend it. Feel free to take a capture of this if you guys want. But there's some pretty cool Elasticsearch specific alerting capabilities. Elastic also has a commercial version, right?
Commercial support.
As well. Yes.
So other than better handling and better processing once you have all of that data, do you think that there's anything we can do to kind of reduce that volume of needles a little bit?
So
it seems like we're over collecting as a rule right now.
So the thought was, are we over collecting? And to me, I think the answer is yes. There are some areas where you can definitively say this type of data is absolute trash. Let's not even waste time on it. But again, you have to go back to regulatory requirements. Sometimes the logs are required. So what are you going to say?
Sorry, I switched off in between.
Sorry about that. Okay, so have you used Greylog before? It is a system that hooks into Elasticsearch.
Yep. Yeah, not a current job, but I've used it before and I've played with it. It's pretty cool.
A taste of my own medicine. I'll ask about the elephant in the room. So obviously we won't know what GDPR is going to mean for logging until we have some court cases where EU tries to leverage that their law supersedes, company XYZ's retention.
Yep.
Do you see any, interesting thing? Do you feel like there will be any caveats to what you just presented based on the holes that GDPR might create?
So that's an interesting conversation. And basically, it's hard because the clock can be right twice a day. But I think there's going to be one of two things that happen with GDPR in regards to data retention and collection. Either one, people are going to stop collecting. I don't think that's possible. There's so many business use cases that are directly tied to that collection. And then option two is there's going to be a huge push towards anonymization of the data, because within GDPR, you can anonymize certain data as long as it's not tied to an individual. And the data governance on that is interesting, because at that point, you're modifying original logs, and there's a lot of modification. It'll be interesting to see the court cases on that, because you're basically tampering with evidence in some of those areas. So they might end up encrypting it so nobody can talk to it and having offline meetings or something. I don't know. It'll be interesting.
It's more original data.
But I would be surprised if people get away from storing original data. They're just going to have to work around it. So and honestly, another story on the GDPR, it's amazing how many people are just panicking on it. It's you guys have known this is happening for 2 years, and you're just now addressing it. I would not want to be part of that.
Everyone hears about ICANN asking for the extension. Not many people realize that we are at the end of the first extension that they gave us. So,
yep. Yeah.
All right, well, that's about all the time we've got. I'm sure he'll be sticking around so we can ask any other burning questions later, but round of applause for the man.
Woo!